Is that good there?
Okay, cool.
Well, thanks everyone for coming out. I appreciate it. I'm Eric Finger, physical therapist here in Austin. Been doing this for about 17 years now. And worked in outpatient, worked for some spine surgeons, worked for Seton, and then worked for Concierge, which is occupational medicine. So I got to see a lot of spine cases and really kind of became very friendly and really enjoyed treating the neck and the back and such. And finally, about a year ago, started my own business. And now I have a mobile practice. So I go to folks' homes and businesses and take care of them and do kind of one-on-one care that way. So, yeah. So, back pain. Let's get into that. So I'm glad you all kind of already shared with me some of the things that are kind of bothering you. But let's find out who else I am. So I'm a dad. I'm a husband. Physical therapist. I also try to do some triathlons here and there, but that is it. And we have one helper here today. Are you helping? You're gonna help? Okay, very good.
Great assistant.
Right. Yeah. Okay, want the next slide here. So back pain. 80% of us are gonna have it at some point in our life. That's how it works. And a lot of the frequency is gonna increase here after 45 years of age and such. In my practice, I see folks who are in their 20s struggling with it, all the way up into their 70s and 80s struggling with it. But the thing is, the back can heal. We can heal, and with some guidance and some nurturing of it, we can get you back to what you love to do. Why is it? Why do we struggle with the back? Does it have to do with some of the things that we do in everyday life? As you can see here, harder working, and then what I see a lot, especially when I was in the occupational setting, is I have folks who come in and tell me, man, my back, my neck are just bothering so much. I'm like, well, how do you sit at work? Well, I sit, I sit like this, and I don't draw, sit up, like that. I'm like, well, we need to stop that. That's one thing we need to do. And I did bring some things. If you are seated quite a bit, I did bring some posture tips that I want to share with you tonight, too. So, it's interesting how we adapt to our work environment instead of adapting the work environment to us. So that's one thing that we're going to talk about a little bit too. Okay. This is when I was in Peru. I just laughed talking about posture and such. This guy was reading the paper on the fence there, and I always just have to show that when I talk about posture. So I just found that the funniest thing. It's how he lays and relaxes there. So there we go. Okay, so I think before we kind of dig in, I just want to do a brief touch on some anatomy here. So I brought the little model, and I'll pass it around here. And this model sits kind of like so. So we've got three curves here, and those curves are normal, okay? We want to have that. We've got it broken down into the neck up here, the cervical spine, the mid-back, the thoracic, and then the lower lumbar area. Most of the back pain that I see tends to be in kind of the mid, the thoracic and the lumbar region and such. So I'll pass this around so you guys can kind of get a little idea. Maybe a little further here. Three main regions, like I said. The lumbar region, which we'll talk more about tonight. There's five different vertebrae there, here. And you'll notice here that these little discs, if you will, they're like little spacers. Think of those as kind of gelatinous. They've got a fibrous coating with a gelatinous core there. Believe it or not, we start seeing changes, even in healthy people. In the 20s, they start kind of breaking down. It's just how it happens. It's natural. It's a natural occurrence and such. So their true job there, though, is kind of stability, if you will. They act as kind of cushions. They're little separators between the vertebrae, but they're also stabilizers, okay? So that's one thing that we'll talk a little further. If they get injured, we lose that stability between the vertebrae and such. So that'll come there. And in this model, that those vertebrae, or excuse me, the disc would be these kind of blackish. Yeah. Okay. But I think the big take-home point from that is that they naturally start degenerating just in our 20s, even then. So that's just something to consider. This is just a closer look here. So we talked about, again, the vertebrae. So we've got them here. We've got the disc right through there. And then one thing I want you to kind of appreciate here is where those two vertebrae meet. They have what we call facets, and that's where they join. And on that, and in the model here, I'll try to do it right here for you guys, what I'm talking about is this right here. And that's how those guys glide on one another. You if you will. Okay? Yeah, okay, so that's how they move. Those will come into play later on. Those can be sometimes issues. They can, you know, some can stem from there. And I also want you to appreciate how close in proximity everything is, right? So if we have an issue with maybe the disc or in, you know, any type of extra bone growth in here, you can see how close that is to the sensitive nerves there, right? Not much room for play there, right? All right. So, and then finally here, these bones right here, just to kind of orient you, are the spinous processes. So if you were to kind of just go down your vertebrae, you're touching these guys right here. Okay? So, all right. Going through here. All right, so I talked briefly about the disc. I like to think of it as that jelly donut. The fibrous outer core through here, the gelatinous core right there. And this is where we'll start seeing, you know, with and even in the 20s, we'll start seeing where this nice rim here actually can breach a little bit. And we can start getting that gelatinous core to start seeping outward. Unfortunately, by design, it's weakest here in the rear of the disc. This is the front, belly button side, this is the back side. That, unfortunately, you can see is where a lot of sensitive structures are. That's a nerve right there, right? So, weakest point is back there, and when we stress over time with different stressors, it could be a car accident, a trauma, or it could be that repetitive bending that you do in your job. Both of those could cause something like this, and again, if it gets to that point, we'll talk about that. You can see how closely approximated it is, and you can see that yellow nerve, a little red, and irritating. Oh, irritating. The good news is, we can change this. The body can change. And we can reduce things like this, and we can heal you up, okay? So, all right, so that's kind of the anatomy. I think what I want to go into are kind of the four typical causes of what I see for folks who come in and see me for back pain. We'll talk about the muscular, maybe that muscular strain, maybe if you were working in the yard or you did kind of a quick pull. We'll talk about the radicular or sciatica. That might be that kind of lancinating sharp pain that goes down the leg. Degenerative disc disease. This might be something where you go to the doc. We're in our fourth, fifth, sixth decade of life. And take an x-ray and the doc typically will say, oh, you've got DDD, degenerative disc disease. Essentially, they're just saying this is the kind of, you've got a back that's been, it's gone through its normal aging process, and we're losing some of that height there. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. And then finally, the sacroiliac joint, which is where the hips and this joint right here, the sacrum, meet. So that would sit right here, like so, and those two hips. So it's this joint right there. This type of issue, what we'll find out, can happen from slips and falls on the buttocks, folks who are real hypermobile, maybe pregnant moms or something like that. So, not as common in the general population. Okay, so back to the muscular pain. What's it look like? This is, you can kind of see in the red. I like this photo because that's kind of what it looks like. You get that irritation through those paraspinal muscles up there. We're not seeing anything radiating to the leg or any numbness or tingling. And it's usually caused by that forceful, maybe a golf swing or a full forceful push-pull when you're doing, you know, yard work or something like that. These I like to treat more with, you know, kind of like a sprained ankle, kind of like the heat or the cold at first, keep moving. We'll talk more about some of the typical mistakes that we do, like with, you know, maybe resting too much when we lay this heel and such. But this is kind of on the minor side of things. The next one that we talked about that I see quite a bit is the radicular or sciatica. Now going back here, hopefully this kind of looks familiar here. Remember earlier I talked about how that disc, if it breaches if that gelatinous, that jelly of the donut starts pushing out, it can impinge upon the nerve there. Even if it's not doing impinging on it, just that gelatinous liquid inside, it's unfortunately an irritant. So if it seeps out a little bit, it can kind of tick things off over here and such. Thing is, we can reduce that disc. Remember you were talking about the McKenzie method, right? We McKinsey method is a, McKinsey was a physiotherapist down in Australia, and he worked a ton with back folks. And his method, which he found out, was that when we extend backwards here, we actually know that we can pull the disc, actually sucks, that material actually gets sucked back into the disc. So his theory, what he did, it was pretty great. He had left a patient in a room in an extended position on a table for like a long time. And when he came back in, the guy's like, my back pain is so much better. What did you do? And he finally put it together that repetitively putting the back into extension helps reduce with pain that is typically caused by, with a disc injury there. Folks with this pain typically are sensitive to sitting. Typically, maybe cough, sneezing, straining, more pain in the morning, walking, standing feel better. And when I hear that in someone's history, when I'm talking with them, the first thing I do during my evaluation is see if we can reduce that pain by doing extension-based exercises and such. And we'll talk more about that too. But this is something that, again, we're dealing with kind of an inflammatory process there. We've got to get that dampened down, but it is totally treatable. And once we reduce the inflammation and get that nerve inflammation down, we see less and less of that radiating pain into the legs. Okay. All right. I'm kind of throwing a lot of science stuff. Is this too much? Are we doing okay with this stuff? Okay. Going on to the third one there, the degenerative disc disease. I guess the big difference here, what I want you to see, is look, compare these guys, to this section here to here. Mm-hmm. Nice, juicy, nice, good spacing, right? And then when we come here, we can see that kind of rippled kind of effect there, and also that nice disc isn't as juicy through there, right? It's a little flatter. And again, when that happens, remember I talked about how we've got nice spacing here. So as we lose this space here, nerve spacing here gets encroached upon, and we lose that nice room through here. So we want that spacing, and when we lose the disc height, everything starts encroaching on one another. So that's where this kind of can be a problem. You can have periodic, numbness and tingling with this. And this would be probably the person where intermittent pain, I get pain 3 or 4 times a year, but it's only after I do something kind of, minor. So it kind of reminds me of your story where you're saying it sounds like it's kind of up and down, but it may be kind of ignited by maybe some benign type of work, right? Some kind of, we'll talk more on how I treat that. And it's kind of the same thing, but it's different in that it's, instead of a big time kind of the disc causing it, it's more just we're losing that nice spacing. Good. All right. And then finally, and I'll be brief about this, the SI dysfunction. Again, typically happens more with females, pregnancy, postpartum, and such. Folks who have maybe taken a fall onto a buttock or even done the splits, that can cause issues here. And again, that pain will usually start right back here on the rear and just kind of hang out there. Pain with extended standing, and also pain with prolonged sitting and walking as well. Okay, so what are some, I wanted to put on here some of the daily activities that we do that stress our back. I found this picture, I'm like, oh, that's perfect, because I can't tell you how many people I used to see in the clinics here, like, all I was doing, I was just cleaning out the bed, in March and such, when we're cleaning out the yard and such, and they sit up and they, stand up from that position, and it's like, yeah, their back's on fire and such. So repetitive stooping and lifting, poor lifting mechanics where your back is rounded, that can really get you in trouble. And that's usually something that I see with a lot of my folks. Extended periods of sitting. My folks who drive a lot, the sitting can be hard on the back, especially with driving because you've got vibration. It can be deleterious to the back as well. And then, lack of exercise, lack of movement is key. And then also smoking can be really hard on the joints. Not the joints, excuse me, but the disc. The disc back here don't have very good blood flow to start with. And with smoking and such, it robs the body of oxygen and such. So blood gives all our tissues the oxygen it needs. So that's one reason that smoking can be really detrimental to the spine and such. Okay. And then are we making these mistakes? So let's say when we have, you know, back pain, are we always going to that ice pack, you know, someone tells us, oh, put an ice pack on it and such. Ice doesn't work for you. You know that you tighten up when you put ice on. Don't do it. Don't do it, you know. I wouldn't put heat right on your back immediately after a, you know, a flare up. But if you know that you're sensitive to ice, especially with a back strain or sprain, and you know that you tighten up with it, I would not put that on there within the first 24 to 48 hours. The other big mistake that I think a lot of people do is resting too much. Maybe that back pain, you have that acute back pain that came on, and the thing we want to do is let's be protective about it. There is new research that came up that said it's not bad for folks who have had an increase in back pain to take it easy, but they're saying for 24 hours maybe, and from that, you've got to get up and start moving and walking and such, because it really is a negative spiral. And we know there's more and more evidence showing how quickly we lose strength by being, you know, in bed, you know, trying to rest and such. So for an acute back pain, I mean, if you catch yourself and you're like, man, I can't move, you know, resting for a bit, but really no greater than 24 hours. Okay. Yeah. And the other big one here is masking it with pain meds.
Wow.
Again, I think we know a lot about pain meds and how they've kind of gone, you know, it's gone way overboard and such, addiction and such. So, but I think the big point for me is if we just keep kind of taking pain meds at it and kind of covering up, are we really going to ever get to the issue? Are we ever going to, you know, like correct it and such? You know, are we just going to kind of just keep that pain at bay and kind of go on with our daily lives? And really what I want to get folks at is me trying to find a solution for it instead of just throwing, you know, pain meds and Advil at it all the time. All right. So, tips to help yourself here. So we talked about, you know, using heat, you know, for stiffness there, and then walking versus a recumbent bike. So these are two general things. I love my folks to, my patients to move, and for my folks with back pain who find that standing, walking feel better, obviously walk. You know, for my patients with back pain who might have it going down both legs, maybe they've been diagnosed with, their doctor said, stenosis, which is a narrowing event. I mean, it can cause pain in both legs. Sitting usually is more comfortable. I want them exercising, but in a seated position. Okay. So two of my favorites for increasing, you know, blood flow to the back and to the legs and building strength are either of these, specific to whatever makes you more comfortable, you know, whatever your back prefers when exercising, okay? So if your back pain, if it responds better to, you know, walking versus sitting, then most definitely want you walking and stuff. And let's talk about your bike, because you brought up a question about the bike, right? Maybe which is better, right? The standard, are we talking like a mountain bike versus a...
Well, it's a hybrid. It's further complicated, but it's more built like a mountain bike.
Mm-hmm.
And but that's only one type of bike that I'm on. And there's the road bike, which is forward.
Yep.
Your back is more approaching parallel,
sure,
to the ground.
Sure.
I was wondering what the effect was on the discs there.
Yeah, I think that's a good question. I don't have the exact statistics on how much the load is there, but I can tell you that if you've got a stiff and sensitive low back, I would think the hybrid where you're more upright, and that is going to be easier on your back. It's going to be tolerated better. Also, the stiffness of the bike, if it every time you hit a bump and the bike's really stiff, if it's all, you know, aluminum or something like that. Some of the bikes these days, the nice ones have shocks and all that fancy stuff. Yeah, that's
the
only thing. Do you have a shock on?
No. But I know we're talking about.
Yeah. Those I've seen are really cushy. But no, that's a good question. So I think for someone, it sounds like in your case, I would think the hybrid would be much better too. And a lot easier on the neck too. I've noticed a lot of my folks with back pain, some like neck pain too, especially with the forward.
It might be the heavy.
What's that?
Oh, it's our light.
There we go. So tell me, you know, with your back pain, tell me about what exercises you like to do, or what, you know, what you find is makes your back comfortable. Can you tell me?
Just doing some yoga exercises.
Mm-hmm.
Some
okay.
of the, yeah.
Good.
Yeah, that's how I find relief.
Relief and
yeah.
such.
Yeah.
Good. And are you going somewhere right now? You
know, not at the moment. I just kind of do it on my own.
Great. Right. Good. You know? But that's your kind of your go-to now.
That's
help
my go-to.
I like it.
That's my go-to.
Perfect.
Yeah, and I like to walk a lot.
Yeah.
You know, every other evening, when I have a chance,
yeah.
I'm not overwhelmed. I take at least a 30-minute walk.
Perfect. Perfect.
You know,
and you find that
I
helpful
find that,
as well.
Oh, it does.
Yeah.
It does. But yeah, there's still times though. You know, like I sleep on my on my left,
mm-hmm.
because it is said that it's better for so that your gallbladder and your liver, you know,
okay.
Have
yeah, so I don't
better circulation.
The digestion and
yeah, yeah, yeah.
And buffer the reflux or not create any acid reflux and stuff. So
okay.
So you know, I try and do those combinations.
Cool.
So
that's
kind of what.
I like that. And I like the flexibility part, and I love the part of the
yeah.
walking.
Yeah.
Powerful.
Yeah,
it's
yeah, yeah,
good
yeah.
stuff. Good deal. Good. Thanks for sharing. Steven, what are your go tos if your back's bothering you? What have you found since?
Well, actually, when I walk, it feels better. I just can't walk that far yet.
Mm-hmm. More of an endurance thing? Or
yeah.
Having that strength?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Great. And did you ever get into a pool, or do you guys have, is anyone with the back pain found the pool helpful for unloading anyone? That's something I usually prescribe for my folks too, because of the unloading factor.
Yeah.
So we get into a pool, not that we have to swim,
right.
Not turning into Mark Spitz or anything, I just want you to walk in there.
Yeah.
And so what I'll, at belly button depth in the pool, you're gonna unload yourself another 50% off there. So for my, going back to that person maybe with a history of a disc injury or something like that, anything where they feel like, man, I just wish someone would pull my legs in and load my spine,
mm-hmm.
I say, let's get to the pool. Mm-hmm. And that can be really helpful because we can combine the benefits of walking with unloading.
Yeah.
So that's something to maybe think about too. If you guys have access to a pool or something
yeah.
like that, just getting in there for water walking and such, really key.
Okay.
I appreciate you sharing. About what you found helpful.
Well, actually, after I took the ibuprofen and I was on a prescription drug and decided this wasn't getting anywhere, I went
yeah.
back to my Pilates class.
I think I had that up here too.
Yes,
yeah,
I
yeah.
saw that up there. I think that's made more difference than anything I've done so far.
Really? Oh, I'm sorry. And are you doing that at a studio right here and such? Great. Love it.
Yeah.
And a lot of the you can probably tell us more about the Pilates and such, but a lot of it stems from kind of engagement of the core muscles
yes.
and then moving the extremities after mm-hmm. having that sturdy foundation. And that's why I love that practice, because that's what I'm teaching my folks, my back pain folks, is becoming oriented with their deep trunk muscles, not the pretty, the rectus abdominis, not where I'm turning into there, no. But we're getting to the fourth deepest layer there, the muscle that actually sits on us like a corset and turning on. I think Pilates does that
mm-hmm.
really well. So you started that, and that's when you started noticing it a little bit. Yes. Love it. That's great. How often are you doing that per week?
Well, my goal is 3, but I'm about 2 right now.
I think it's great though. That's good. Yeah. Any aerobic activity too? Do you walk?
Some walking.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
And you find that helpful as well?
Love it.
Good deal.
Cool.
Great. So biking mostly for you?
Yeah, remiss in not walking more. It's mental.
It's hard to walk when it's 101 degrees out at 7:30.
It's tedious. The pedals are exciting. You're going fast. There's dogs after you and stuff. It's great.
Well,
it's okay. I'll do it. And it's the wind, you can generate your own wind chime, so. Get back and start walking.
There's,
you know, buy a bike and then I'll start walking.
But biking seems to be more your preference. Yeah. You do it, and if it's not bothering you, you can make
3 hours. 3 hours on a good day, 2.5 on an okay day, 5 days a week.
That you were biking that much?
Yeah, that's fine. Well, I don't know. I'm blowing a disc out.
Well, I don't want, no. I don't want us to go, we're not, I want you to leave here thinking that we've got, you know.
Superman.
The exercises is important. We'll talk further on that. The last thing I want to do is, you guys worry about them. Back over here. So I love what I'm hearing here because you guys are doing, we've already talked about the yoga here, we talked about Pilates, we talked about the walking, still working on building that endurance and such, and then the biking as well. I think the other big one, me coming from, again, I did occupational medicine, so I was dealing with folks who were sitting all day. Here in Austin, I deal with a lot of tech folks, even 30-year-olds who are coming to me with back and neck pain. They're just hammering away at their laptop for 10 hours at a time and wondering why the heck they've got tingling in their hands and such. So one of the first things I'm telling them, are you taking breaks? No, I usually go at it for 3 hours. So out of rest the tissues, we've got to change that. So I suggest, you know, anyone who's sitting for long periods of time to take what I call little micro breaks. You know, so if you're sitting, getting up, go grab, you know, some water, doing some stretches and such, and you know, even thinking about you know, folks who are at a desk a lot, those stand desks are really, really key. And there's actually new evidence out there showing that those reduce neck pain and such. There's a nice study that just came out and such. And so I don't know if that affects you guys. I don't know if you're at a desk all day, but if that's something, if the back and neck pain is bothering there, those standing desks can be quite helpful. The ones that adjust you. So that's really good. Yeah. So how do we treat successfully? I think in my time, I think the biggest thing that I've learned is, the biggest, most important part is listening here. So when I have a new patient coming in during the evaluation, I want them to tell me their story, tell me about it. If I listen to the patient, they'll tell you exactly what's hurting, how long, you know, what's going on. You can really garner the information you need and really kind of find out what the true cause, root cause of. And I think that's another thing that kind of really drives my practice, is that I'm going after the root cause of folks' issues. So you come to me with back pain, that's what we're here talking about. I'm looking at the whole system. Is it an issue with, you know, the down at the foot that's caused something? Is it a knee issue? I think I spied on your knee there.
Yeah.
So is that a total knee?
Oh yeah.
So when I think of that, I'm wondering, how is that person, you know, how long has that been there? How have they been getting to the ground to pick up things? Well, they got a bum knee. It sure as heck isn't like this. It's more like this. And I remember I talked earlier about repetitive stooping and such. So I'm looking at behavior patterns that we can, you know, help change, and giving folks kind of the education they need. Put a halt on maybe some offending things that we're overlooking, that we just have habits that we've gotten into and such. So, may I ask you some questions on that? I know we've got an open room. How long were you battling with any pain before you had that stroke? Long time.
Yeah, because I put it off as long as I possibly could.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, years.
Was it years?
Yeah.
And then the back pain, were they right there together, or was this something that...
No, the back pain's been more recent.
Has it? Okay. Yeah. Okay, and such. So those are things that we're going to look at, too. You know, it's not just put it, you go really, you know, dive to the back, to look at the whole person, and really kind of get to the root cause of the pain. So, that flows right into at the education part, empowering folks with ultimately being in control of their pain instead of it controlling you. That's, I think, the biggest part, because we can do it. I've got a great story. A young gal I'm working with right now, 31 years old. I was working with her mom and her dad originally, and then they said, "I want you to talk with, you know, Lauren. She's not good." She's a young gal. She's a IT. She was in her bed more often than she was up before we met. And this is, we started working together early this past summer. Was told by two spine surgeons that she has a broken back. That's what they told her. That's how they left it. So she assumed that every time she had pain, she needed to just rest, and that's what she did. She would just stay in bed and such. So the reason I like to bring that up is from day one, we had to talk about kind of understanding pain and knowing that every time we feel a pain, it doesn't automatically mean that we're doing harm and such. We had to really kind of adjust our thinking, and the problem is that her pain had been around for it's been about 9 years. So when chronic pain's been around like that, our system changes. Let's think of our pain as kind of an alarm system. The threshold for the alarm to go off gets lowered so much it doesn't take much to, you know, essentially a light breeze can set it off, if you will. And we've got to work on one thing that I practice on is teaching that nervous system to kind of to calm down and not be so, you know, that. So that's part of it too. It's not just, again, you know, just doing strength exercises and pelvic tilts and bridging and such like that, but it's also the education on and teaching the nervous system to kind of dampen down and such. But so the cool part, I'm kind of jumping over, but the cool part of the story is that she texted me, she and her family were up in Canada, and she texted me the other night. She's like, "Hey, kicking butt on ping pong. I haven't played ping pong. They didn't know I was that good." She goes, "I won't say exactly what she said, but she goes, I'm kicking butt." And I'm like, love it. So I've partnered with this young lady to help her get back to be moving. She's dancing with her husband and such. You know, she's newly married and thought she just, you know, her social life wasn't there anymore. And so we're really, that's what I like to do, is help folks get back to their, you know, the things they want to do and such. And it's just been, it's been great. She's been great to partner with and such, and it's just exciting to see her back doing things and enjoying life, especially at 31 years old. So I bring that story up in particular because this is someone who just thought, this is what I'm going to have to deal with, and didn't even know if she was going to be able to have children, because she was really worried about during pregnancy how that would affect her back and such. So it hit on a lot of real important points for her, and she's now just her. When we first met, the whole demeanor was just here, and now she's up, and it's just really, it's really cool. So but that was one story I wanted to share. Right, let's see, can we get this back on up here? All right. So questions do we have? Anything that I know, we went through that intense anatomy lesson up front, and I hope, I don't know, what did you learn, or what was something interesting that you didn't know that maybe you heard tonight here? Anything that struck you?
The notion of teaching the nervous system when to proceed even though it hurts, or when to back off if it hurts. That's if you could speak to that further.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sure.
I'm in the camp that, well, you know, you have to understand the coaching philosophy.
Sure.
Philosophy in the 70s, where most of those guys came out of World War II and things.
Yeah.
You know, you're not hurting unless the bone is sticking out.
Yeah, sure.
So.
Sure, sure. Kind of go on that.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So I blew out a knee years ago, and I had to go back into therapy on it, and they taught me, well, in recent years, it was not like when, you know, when I blew it out in the mid-90s, I had a different thing going on. And, they were talking about relearning using the other knee joint to to teach this one to be okay with its modified self, so.
Okay. So, and then back to your pain, but your question, let me go back to this, a couple questions, so kind of like.
Probably about 30, sorry.
No, no, you're good. I just want to make sure I'm on top of those. So going back to the pain, yeah. So let's go back to Lauren's story. Remember the gal who I was just talking about, how I'm living, this will help kind of bring it back. So the first thing I did was give her a book to talk about it. There's a nice book out, Four Patients, that speaks, you know, in a layperson's language that really helped her kind of like connect the dots, because I can spew all this anatomy and such and just didn't connect. So she got to learn on her own that it's this alarm, her alarm system was just super exciting. When folks have pain for that long, the pain mediators, we'll call them, the little ingredients that kind of aggravate the tissue, we have a lot of things that do that in our bodies, their volume grows, which makes the nerves depolarize like even quicker and such. So with those changes in there, what we've got to do is teach the body through touch, through massage, through exercise, that hey, you don't need to depolarize. You don't need to let us know that you're there with a simple task of, you know, walking up the stairs or something like that. So it's kind of multifactorial. It's using tissue work. It's using exercise, but it's also teaching the system that hey, you can dampen down. You don't need to alert us to that. And also, I think it's also a lot of education yourself, you know, for the patient itself, just knowing that, you know, in Lauren's case, again, when she'd be walking, she'd get these twinges, and she would just freeze, and she would be guarded and probably go right back home. Now she knows when she has a twinge like that, she pauses, and then she continues with her day and such. So that right there, that mindset, that change right there, and knowing that, having that confidence was huge for her. And that's what we kind of had to start with in the beginning, is knowing, yeah, you're back. It's going to maybe twinge on you, but it doesn't mean that you need to go back home. It means you can continue with whatever you were out doing, the shopping or whatever you're doing. So so it's kind of some behavioral things, but it's also us doing, the therapist getting in there and doing some, you know, tissue work and kind of nurturing the nerve, making sure it's mobility. What's interesting about the nerves, they need to lengthen and shorten just like the muscles. And if their movement isn't good, that can make them be a little more talkative and such. So that's where on my end, as a PT, I'll go in and work on establishing better nerve mobility, giving you exercises to help promote that as well. So patient has work to do, you know, maybe doing, you know, kind of some reorganizing on their thoughts with pain and such, and then we do some physical work too, to the nerves and such. That all together helps kind of make that alarm system, increases the threshold before it goes off and such. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, cool. That's a good question. I appreciate that. What else? Anything else? You guys, questions?
I've been using like the same pillow forever, but there are times that all of a sudden I wake up and did I sleep wrong? Mm-hmm. Did I, you know, but I normally, and maybe because I'm really not awake, you're so asleep that you don't realize how much you move, you know? But according to me, if I lay down and I just stay the same, you know, position
yeah,
pretty much the whole night.
Okay.
And then you wake up and you go, what happened here?
What happens there?
Yeah.
Typically, what can happen, particularly up in the neck, is when we, remember I talked about these joints here, right?
Mm-hmm.
So each of those joints, imagine like a little balloon, if you will, it covers it, it's called a capsule, okay, mm-hmm. that encapsulates that joint there. If we sleep, you know, one of the big offenders are folks who sleep on their belly with their head turned.
Mm-hmm.
If you do that, really what we're doing is putting stress on those joints for an 8-hour period. And what can happen is it's not the stress so much, but it's just that being in that position, the joint can actually kind of dry up and it gets stuck. So sometimes those little kinks we feel when we wake up and we can't get there, it's just the joint not able to glide effectively. Kind of that little capsule gets pinched. and such. It works itself out, right? After all that muscle guarding, after what, 4 or 5 days or so sometimes, maybe sometimes longer, and then we're like, oh, I need help. You know?
So is it not recommendable to sleep on your stomach because you're putting that much stress on your back?
My concern for folks, for belly sleepers, is the stress on the neck for being there a long time. That can kind of catch up with you there.
Okay.
Now, some folks with back pain, you know, really like to be on their belly and such. But I caution them on, you know, beware that that can be a little stressful on the. I typically suggest folks sideline with pillows between the knees. If you're a side sleeper, sometimes there's contoured pillows for the neck. Are you guys familiar with that? Maybe the Tempur-Pedic waveform pillow, yeah. The bigger hump for the side sleeper, the smaller hump, use that for a back sleeper to support the neck. Okay, and such. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What positions do you guys like to seek out when you're, if your back's bugging you? Are you back sleepers, side sleepers, or?
I'm a back sleeper.
You're back, yeah. You guys,
more
preference?
Back, sometimes on the side.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Back, sometimes it for back sleepers too, putting a pillow underneath the legs, underneath the knees to bend those can be helpful too, just to take some stress off the lower back and such. Okay. Yeah, great. That's a good question.
Yeah.
Appreciate that. Anything else, guys? Anything else I said that was a little confusing or anything that resonated with you?
Well, greater insight to sciatica, because, you know, for the life of me, just like you described it, these electrical shocks going through, and just.
What about those Sims you had? I had a birthday that ended in 0, and my upstart younger relative handed me a Sim unit. It's one of those little pain thing.
Electrodes.
Is that the Sim kind of? Yes.
So there's tens. There's tens.
That's what it is.
So trans electrical neurostimulation. So essentially, the way I think of TENS is that I think Shaquille O'Neal now sells them on TV now. Yeah, so we've got 2 or 3 electrodes, and we turn it on. Essentially think of, if this is the pain signal here, and we've got the sensory here, and we've got pain, and we've got sensation here. So it's either, you can go to one connection here, and if you've got the pain here, when you turn on that stim, it's going to connect there, and it doesn't allow the other pain to connect here and send that pain signal down. So it's essentially putting pain on call waiting. Remember call waiting? That's the best analogy I can give it, right? So once you take that TENS off, here returns the pain. So TENS, I don't really subscribe. They can help because they're really just giving you that sensation to kind of like almost. Remember how we say if you hit your ankle but pinch yourself and it deters? Yeah, it's kind of in that same thing. It's called the gate control theory. So we're kind of rerouting, you know, where the brain is kind of thinking about it and such. So again, putting the pain signals on call waiting is kind of how the TEN works. Now they have, you know, if you go to a chiropractor or a physical therapy clinic and they might put you on interferential current. Does that sound familiar? IFC, anyone use that? Did you ever have that in your UT experience? Okay. Good. I like that because modalities are passive, and we don't like people doing passive stuff when we're in PT talents.
Yeah.
Interferential it penetrates a little deeper, so you get some natural release of some of the kind of natural pain relieving mediators that we have in the body. So that's gives you a little, you know, like instead of turning the TENS off and that pain coming back, the interferential can give you about 3 hours of relief and such, because it almost feels like you have a constant buzz going on, you know, down there at the back and such. So overall, with those, I'm not a big, you know, for my acute injuries, like I have a little portable stim unit that I'll give to my folks for like a, you know, for a knee sprain or ankle sprain for maybe those first 24 to 72 hours. And I'll use that with ice or something like that for an acute injury, but after that, push the passive stuff to the side and such. So some people swear by it, and that's good, but it's just I want to quickly get away from passive modalities as quick as I can when I'm rehabbing. So, yeah, good question. And you'll see them. I mean, I think you can get them at CVS, Walgreens, these days and such. Yeah.
A question for you?
Yes.
Not that it's my case, but, you know, we're gracefully aging. And, you know, can you speak a little bit at all, you know, with arthritis? I know, for example, my sister's been battling chronic arthritis when she was 30. It was just complicated more and more. And she recently visited from San Diego, and there were times that she would just freeze, bend over, and just started breathing deep because she was having such pain, lower back pain, and then her hips. And so when she got back, she goes, that her doctor had suggested, her RA doctor had suggested hip replacement. I mean,
okay, so you just said one thing that cued me. So she's been diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So rheumatoid arthritis is it's essentially where the body is going to start, an immune system attacks the body. It starts going after the joints, and you get it as accelerated arthritis. It typically happens on both sides, mm-hmm. hip joints, the knees, the fingers, and such. Mm-hmm. So it's an accelerated form of osteoarthritis that we, but it can be very debilitating. Mm-hmm. And if it deteriorates the joints enough, then, and it can be, you know, bone on bone where there's not much left, that's where they might, that's when they start suggesting doing hip replacements and such. Yeah, I've dealt with a patient, she was 21, and she had rheumatoid arthritis, and she needed her first total joint at age 21.
Wow.
So it can be very, act very quickly, you can really go after the tissues.
Yeah.
So that was my first question.
The time is 7:55, please bring all items for checkout to the circulation.
First question.
So, PT is the way, would be the recommended therapy for her?
For her? My first thought would be, does she like the water? Can we get her into a pool? Can we unload? Can we take the stress off those joints? Well, that's the first thing I would think. If there's a modality, and there's aquatic therapy, there's aquatic classes, but if the unloading of the knees, I'm sure she has, well, I know that you'd said the hips are not in the best of shape, or
that's,
that was right. Yeah. So I would think something more low load, but something that'll allow her to move.
Mm-hmm.
So the pool's a nice way to kind of take away gravity and allow those joints to be freer. So we get the benefits of movement and benefits of exercise and oxygen, blood flow, but not the pounding.
Yeah.
Yep.
Interesting.
That would be my first thought there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Great
and
question.
And how is one, you know, thank God, you know, has, one never knows if you're going to have that or not, you know. What would be your preventative recommendation for, you know, just the continuing exercise and the...
Well, RA can be, have a genetic component to it too. So is there a family history?
No.
Or no? There's none. No. Yeah, so I first thought that one, prevention-wise, there's medications that are helping with it now with RA, they can be kind of good, but preventive-wise, it's kind of, that's something that can just develop.
Yeah.
And I've seen it as young as early 20s.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
interesting. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, osteoarthritis, the arthritis that we think of from, I'm just getting old, my knees are creaking and such.
Yeah.
Those, especially in the lower extremity joints, to prevent that type of arthritis, I think of exercise. The healthy habits, you know, wear a weight, you know, particularly in the knees and the hips to offset that. Our body weight can be really detrimental there. Those are things. So I think just the general wellness part of it.
Sometimes she says that she feels like there's no energy in her hands.
Sure, yeah. When the joints become that affected, the muscles that move those joints get affected as well, and they lose their force output. That's very common.
Mm-hmm.
Very common. Yeah. Well, I wish her. Yeah, I want her to. Maybe she can seek out some aquatic therapy. That would be.
She's been trying to. She did. I mean, when she had the onset of her arthritis at age 29, she went all, how to say, natural. Just you know, trying to stay away from steroids and everything.
Yeah.
But
because that's what we use quite a bit of.
Yeah.
And the steroids are deleterious to the body as well.
Exactly.
Too much steroid can eat away at the bones too.
It's
hard. Yeah. Well, that's a great question. I appreciate that. Finally here, next steps. A couple things. If you're looking, if I answer questions tonight and you're curious about, you know, moving forward and getting some help for you. I'd love to talk to you about, you know, scheduling and evaluation. If you're still like, I like what you said, but I'm still curious on if you could help me out, I also have a discovery visit. It's a free 30-minute consultation where I'll come to you guys and kind of continue the conversation, learning more about, you know, if we're looking for a solution to your pain and kind of what your needs are, and find out if we're the right match and such. So, so I'd be happy to, if you are interested in that, let me know. We can get something set up. That's kind of my presentation tonight. I hope we answer maybe a few questions and such. And if anything pops up, I have my card over here, and I've got your emails too. I'll probably be following up with you. And please reach out. And then these little ebooks that I have here, if they look interesting, let me know which one, and I'll get that sent over to you with the URL so you can download that and such. So.
Thank you. Yeah. It was very educational.
Good.
You know, it was the main purpose of my coming, just to learn more, because we don't know it all.
Good.
And we're changing, yeah, you know, as we go. So
yeah, well, good.
It's important to get
as we go
older. What's that?
Every time in my special hospital, as we grow older.
Every explanation, as we grow older, you know, so you know what's coming.
It's not, the spirit doesn't grow older.
No,
the body does.
Yeah.
We have no control over that.
That's right.
You know, it's true. So it's a reality check. Yeah. You know, that's where we are.
But keep moving. That's what I want you guys to keep.
Okay. Thank you so much.